As if being an isolated, alienated spectator to a slow-moving apocalypse wasn't enough, I recently asked myself, how can I make myself more miserable? And the answer that came to me was to read a really shitty book. And so I read India Unbound by Gurcharan Das. For those who don't know, and shame on you by the way, Das is a former Procter & Gamble executive turned author, public intellectual and philosopher who published this ambitious mix of memoir and history way back in 2002 to national and international acclaim. Highly enthusiastic praise from the likes of the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Financial Times, the Economist, the Guardian, etc. catapulted Das to the status of India's eminent free market apostle, who predicted a golden future for 21st century India as it would throw off the shackles of its colonial past and its failed post-independence socialist experiment to embark on a path of prosperity by embracing the power of markets, capital, and competition. The theme of this book, Das explains, is how a rich country became poor and will be rich again. And to tell us this grand story, he relies on his breathtaking knowledge of an impressive variety of academic disciplines such as history, economics, philosophy, sociology, management, theology, political science, and psychology. Now, I have to be honest here, I tried to take this book seriously. I really did. I mean, I knew it was going to piss me off and I was ready for that. That was the whole point. But I was really not prepared for how comically stupid it is. I mean, you look at the reviews and everyone is bedazzled by his seemingly infinite wisdom and seduced by his elegant prose. And then you read the damn thing and you think, this is hilarious. This guy is a clown. He is more or less the same person as my dear friend and mentor, Shekhar Gupta. Every dumb thing that Shekhar has ever said, Gurcharan Das also believes. At their core, both of them believe the same things. The only difference is that Gurcharan Das writes a little bit better and usually has some kind of intellectual justification for his bullshit views, however shaky it may be. Basically, both of them are serving you the same shit sandwich. And Shekhar's is made with like the simple Mrs. Bechter's white bread, but Gurcharan Das is serving it to you with like a fancy French baguette, so you feel a little bit classy, even though, you know, you're still eating shit. And if you think I'm exaggerating how bad this book is, let me present you with some concrete examples. This is an actual quote from the book wherein Mr. Das is attempting to explain how India got poorer under British rule. The British Raj could not raise economic growth or lift the people out of poverty. It could not avert famines. The truth is that the Raj was economically incompetent. It just did not know how to develop a country. Now, I don't blame anyone for thinking that I've cherry-picked this particular quote to make Das look as stupid as possible, but seriously, this isn't even the dumbest thing he says about the British Empire in the book. Later on, he contends that running the empire was not terribly profitable for the British and that not developing India was a great loss for Great Britain as well as India. I don't want to put words in Gurcharan Das's mouth. But if you read these quotes along with others where he says that the British gave us democracy, the rule of law, an independent judiciary and a free press and built railways, canals and harbors, I think he comes dangerously close to endorsing the whole white man's burden theory as a justification for British imperialism. Because if they weren't pursuing any material interests in India, if there was no systematic exploitation of India, if in fact they were losing money in order to give us all these nice things, then maybe they were here to civilize us natives and prepare us for the modern world, right? I understand I'm delving into conjecture here, but the question does arise. Why is Das so eager to absolve the British Empire of all its ghastly crimes, especially when it makes him come across as a bumbling imperial apologist? Is he not aware of the work of a long line of Indian nationalist leaders, starting with Dadabhai Nauroji in the second half of the 19th century, who held that specific British policies enacted very consciously were responsible for siphoning away India's wealth in order to transfer it to British industrial and financial interests? And a lot more work was done in this direction by Marxist economists in the post-independence period. Das is aware of all this, but he rejects it in favor of a thesis drawn largely from a weighty tome known to the public as the second volume of the Cambridge Economic History of India, or CEHI, but which really ought to be known by its true name, Why the British Did Nothing Wrong. The Marxist historian Irfan Habib labeled the book as an exercise in studying a colonial economy without even perceiving colonialism, and I will link his paper critiquing the CEHI in the description below, but we don't need to be bogged down by the details to know the usefulness of this book to people like Gurcharan Das. The CEHI provides a semblance of an intellectual justification for dissociating the horrible outcomes of colonial rule from the economic ideology that shaped colonial policy. And that is really what Das is trying to salvage here, the economic ideology of our colonial rulers. Why? Well, because he himself is a lifelong advocate of the same ideology and he doesn't want it to be associated with the impoverishment of his own country. The economic principles he espouses, so-called free trade based on comparative advantage, a small fiscally restrained state, complete freedom to foreign capital, no labor regulations, etc. All these principles, which he will tell you are scientifically proven to bring about prosperity, are the same ones that guided the policy making of British officials to a very large extent. The goal of this book is to sell the 1991 liberalization reforms as the cure to all of India's woes, and that goal would be greatly undermined if he was to admit that similar policies had actually created a lot of our woes in the first place. So he has to find something else to blame, and he settles on general incompetence. And that really tells you all you need to know about this book's academic pretensions. There is no noble pursuit of truth here. All there is a self-serving exercise in morally and intellectually justifying his own obscene wealth and the wealth of his friends. There's another advantage in letting the British off the hook. If the centuries-long catastrophe of colonial rule was just a long series of blunders and not at all related to economic ideology, then one can frame the policies pursued by the post-independent state as purely the result of left-wing ideological zealots inflicting their irrational prejudices against markets and free trade and capital onto the country. Like, the only reason for trying to restrict trade in agriculture post-independence was, according to people like Das, that Nehru and the people around him were just hardcore socialist ideologues who simply had an intrinsic dislike and suspicion of the free market. It wasn't like unrestricted trade in food grains was responsible for tens of millions of famine deaths in the second half of the 19th century. No. That was just an administrative mistake. You know, a couple of minor whoopsies. So not only does he wholly reject the nationalist critique of colonial rule, but then he spends most of the book unsurprisingly shitting on the post-independence leadership for letting their ideology blind them from the advantages of the free market, entrepreneurship, and competition. There is nothing much to note about this part of the book, honestly. It's all the same standard boring stuff we've heard a million times before. Government bad, unions bad, markets good, foreign capital good. All this stuff is so viciously debunked by now, it's still a surprise people genuinely believe in it. Ha-Joon Chang's book, Kicking Away the Ladder, probably offers the most concise refutation I know of the idea that any of the so-called developed countries, right from the early industrializers like Britain, Germany, USA, etc., to the latecomers like the East Asian economies, none of these countries ever relied on the neoliberal policy package to industrialize and develop. It never happened. There is not a single developed country that ever developed in any meaningful sense by adopting the policies people like Das argue for. And now we come to the part of the book that is the funniest to read today. Gurcharan Das's predictions of a golden Indian future. And these are important not just because we can laugh at them, which we will do shortly, but also because through reading these predictions, it is possible to at least try to grasp the true insanity of the period in which this book was written and published. See, back in the tail end of the 90s, back when folks were still riding the end of history wave in the wake of the collapse of the Soviet Union, back when these same folks regarded free market capitalism as the perfect mode of running society, whose success could be replicated in every single country on the planet, no matter its state of development. Well, you can understand in that kind of heady environment, it is possible to make oneself believe pretty much anything. Because at that point, these guys were just getting high off their own supply, you know? Especially since 9/11, the Iraq war, and the 2008 global financial crisis hadn't happened yet to ruin that sweet, sweet buzz. And in the diluted haze of that sweet buzz, people like Gurcharan Das and all his cheerleaders in India and in the foreign press convinced themselves that there was literally no problem under the sun that could not be solved by the market. Fuck poverty, unemployment, and inequality. Those aren't even problems anymore. We're coming for caste and gender discrimination, environmental degradation, social conflict. For every problem, the answer was more markets. And this produces some of the most ludicrous passages in the book, like this one, in which Das, after musing on how socialism kept Indians from being better team players, writes that the free market will actually solve that problem and improve workplace cohesion. I believe that with more competition in the Indian market, we will get better teamwork in the business world. When companies fight for survival, there is less luxury for egotistical behavior. We sink or swim together. Since the 1991 reforms, Indian markets have become more competitive. Cohesion should gradually increase. I guess this is hardly a controversial opinion. Everyone knows that when there's more competition in the economy and in the workplace, when everyone is out there on their own, looking out for their own narrow self-interests, when you have to fight every second of your life to get one over the person sitting next to you, when you are locked in a Darwinian struggle for survival every single day, when the whole damn economy is pretty much like the Hunger Games, everyone knows that that is when team spirit truly flourishes. Anyway, here's another passage where he is just rambling about how India, thanks to its amazing IT entrepreneurs, will simply skip industrialization and leap straight into the utopia of the information age. You might want to strap in, because this is a really, really wild one. Ever since Indians began to succeed in Silicon Valley and Bangalore, people have wondered why we have been more successful in software and information related business than in the old smokestack industries. My hypothesis is that Brahmins have had thousands of years of experience in dealing with abstract philosophical and spiritual concepts of the Upanishads. This may explain why Indians are especially good at mathematics and theoretical physics. Indians invented the zero, the information age, thus plays to our strengths. I mean, that's just simple logic, right? We know that all code is just binary, right? Zeros and ones. So we already know zero, we invented it. So basically, we know half of all code, right? Anyway, he continues. After all, cyberspace, like spiritual space, is invisible. Our core competence may well be invisible. I'm sorry. Apparently, Amartya Sen said this was a wonderful book. Anyways, it is not surprising that an unusually large number of IT entrepreneurs, both in Silicon Valley and in South India, come from the Brahmin caste, not from the traditional trading castes. Hence, I believe that we may actually skip the Industrial Revolution and leap right into the Information Revolution. And on and on and on he goes like this for hundreds of pages, making one glorious prediction after another. The only problem that Das foresees is that the homogenizing effects of capitalism might make Indians lose touch with their roots and their culture. Well, no need to worry about that, Grandpa, because the BJP already took care of it. They found a way to reduce Indian culture to the most loud, most crass, most violent, the most lowest common denominator, most WhatsAppable commodified form, and use it to spread cancer in society. And it's great to see that the culture of a great Vedic civilization, which Gurcharan Das keeps crying on and on about, is now just guys sending rape threats to women on social media. And you know what? You love to see it. Honestly, there is so much garbage here, I could keep going for hours. But in conclusion, all the funny, delusional stuff in this book is not worth the brain damage reading it will give you. The only reason I would recommend reading this book to anyone is if you're a little bit mad like me and want to get a flavor of how poisoned everyone's minds were in the late 90s. In that sense, it truly is a relic of its time, and it has the same sort of historical value that a Baba Sehgal song has. Sure, it sounds corny and weird now, but that's just what people were into back in the 90s, man. So, for being this strange historical curiosity, I will give India Unbound by Gurcharan Das 2 out of 10 stars. That's all. Thank you for watching. And if you have an awful book recommendation, do leave it in the comments. Now get out of here.
नहीं बोलूंगा ये तूने कैसे जाना मेरे यार हे हे तो देखो देखो कैसे चलती है वो हसीना जैसे चले है को हिरनी की जात मैं तो जाऊंगा पकड़ूंगा छेड़ूंगा जाऊंगा बोलेगी वो ना 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 ना